instead of figures, growth chart is a visual impression of how the child is doing. So we simply plot the weight and the height on the growth charts and see whether they are within the permissible limits. So actually growth charts, people are very scared of growth charts, plotting growth charts because of many reasons. Because there are numbers involved, there is an x-axis, there is a y-axis, there is an age, and I mean too many things. Okay. So, but it is not difficult at all. We will discuss that later. In fact, it is a pediatrician's friend, and my duty is to build up your friendship with the growth charts. Okay, just by plotting the parameters, the height as well as the weight on the growth charts, you can simply see how wonderfully the child is doing. Okay, if he is following his normal curve, you can assure yourself first and also the parents that your child is on the right path. He's on the road to health and that he's not taken any wrong turns. So then what, apart from reassuring yourself and the parents, why is growth charting important? So in majority of the children, they do well naturally, just God takes care of everything. But a few of them deviate. They take a wrong turn. Okay, so from the road, on their road to health, they take a wrong turn. And this is what we have to detect at the earliest. And this is possible only by regular plotting of the chart. If they are deviating from their curve, you know that something is wrong. And it is timely, you know, you need to pick these deviations very, very early before it is too late. So most important importance of the growth chart is to reassure yourself that the child is well, to reassure the parents that the child is doing well, to pick up abnormal growth deviations at the earliest. And lastly, sometimes if you follow the trends, if you plot all the parameters and you see a trend that he's plateauing, he's, you know, shooting up or he's going down, you know that definitely this is an abnormality, and based on the trend you can make diagnosis. So we make clinical diagnosis based on the growth charts, how the curve looks. Okay, so it is not only the pediatricians, it is a doctor's best friend. Okay, so now we know about growth charts. So where do we get these growth charts from? Okay, so you all must be wondering, where do we get them from? So IAP has presented to us growth charts for children 5 to 18 years and also 0 to 5 years. Okay, so the 5 to 18 years growth charts, these are basically done after a lot of work has been done on Indian children 5 to 18 years of age by Dr. Khadilkar and his team. Okay, they surveyed the entire country and they took the height and the weights of children of all ages, 5 to 18, boys and girls, from all corners of India. So from north, south, east, west, they took the heights and the weights of 5 to 18 years old children, and they presented them in the form of growth charts. So IAP has presented these to us. So we can, we can use it as a reference. So for 5 to 18, I will show the charts later, we use the IAP, new IAP growth charts 2017. So this is how they look. Blue is for boys, pink is for girls. The growth charts have, this is for height, this is for weight. They are beautifully presented on a single paper so that you can compare how is the weight and how is the height. You can compare them relative to each other. Okay. Also, we have the body mass index charts. Okay. So on one side, we have the height and the weight. On the back side, we have the body mass index charts. And you all see that they are all presented as percentile lines. So from first percentile, third, 25th, 50th. Okay. And I will talk about these percentile lines later. Okay, this is for girls. Again, weight, height, BMI. Okay, now the next question I would like to ask you is, why should we use country-specific charts? So I said that IAP has provided to us growth charts for specifically based on the studies done on Indian children. So why are country-specific charts very important? Because I can give you an example. Like when we were residents in pediatrics way back, we used to refer to the Nelson charts. Okay, the growth charts which are given in Nelson's textbook. And they were the American charts. And our children used to do very badly on those charts. Whenever we used to plot the height and the width, they always used to be many times even below the third centile, which is, according to our definition, grossly abnormal. So then we were told that their 50th is our 90th. So based on this, we would calculate it used to be very cumbersome. So their 50th centile corresponds to our 90th centile. So very tedious and very, it used to be very difficult. And I used to wonder why don't we have charts, Indian charts, which are based on growth of Indian children. So studies were done later on, and recently what we have are the most recent 2017 Indian growth charts. So why do we need country-specific growth charts? This is because human growth differs in amongst various ethnic groups. The final heights and the growth curves are different for different children. Indians are different, Southeast Asians are different, then we have the Caucasians are different, Africans are different. So every country should have their own country-specific charts, which we have, and we should be very proud of that. Now, so they are largely caused by the respective reference population characteristics, the different growth patterns among the different regions. So use country-specific charts. Now, this is a small study to show why country-specific charts are more appropriate. A small study was done where 150 boys who were referred to us, this was done in our institute, 150 boys who were referred for short stature were plotted on the growth charts. And we found that out of the 150 boys, all were not short. So this tells us that many times we get reference for short stature, but they are not really short. They do not fit into the definition of short stature. So 10% of the children were not short on the Indian charts, but the same we plotted on the American charts or the CDC charts, and we found that only 2% were not short. Got my point? So 10% were not short in the Indian charts, 2% were not short in the American charts. This means that the difference of 8% were classified as short stature on the American charts. They were unnecessarily investigated, money was spent, and it was an unnecessary waste of investigations when the child was absolutely normal and the tests did not reveal, that clinically these children were absolutely normal. So this tells us that the importance of using appropriate growth charts. Now, coming to 0 to 5 years of age, what would you use? We use the WHO charts. So who have prepared these charts? The WHO has made these charts, and they are for use all over the world. Now you would say, on one hand you say we should use country charts, but WHO charts are basically to be used all over the world. The reason is because they have conducted the study on children all over the world, including India as a center, and they tell us how children should normally grow. So to universalize the whole pattern across the globe, they have recommended to use WHO growth charts for children 0 to 5 years of age. Okay. Now, they look like this. If you see, what is different between the 0 to 5 and the 5 to 18 years? Can you tell me? Any difference? This is an additional feature. Okay. So in the 0 to 5 years, you have height. This is for height, this is for weight, and this is for head circumference. Why? Because the child, up to 5 years, the maximal brain growth is in the first 2 years, and he continues to grow at a certain pace till the age of 5 years. So it is very, very important to even look for the head circumference. So head circumference being brain growth being a part of the early years, it is given only in the 0 to 5 years age group. So these are the WHO growth charts, but IAP has presented them very simply. What do I mean simply? These are the simplified IAP charts of WHO. Simplified charts means that all the parameters are presented on one single page. Okay, so when you chart the height, you chart the weight, and you chart the head circumference, you can compare each one of them, and which can help us in diagnosing that certain condition. Okay, so blue for boys, pink for girls again. Now, which are these charts for 0 to 5? They are not BMI charts. They are the weight for length charts or weight for height charts. Have you heard of weight for height charts? So these are age independent here. Age does not come into picture. So even if you do not know the age of the child, you can easily classify the child as whatever, you know, malnutrition or obesity if he is having. So these charts are used for diagnosis of wasting or malnutrition in children. These are the weight by height charts. Okay, these are for girls. Okay, now we also have a combination charts. Okay, so to make things easier, IAP has combined both the charts, 0 to 5 and 5 to 18. So on one single paper, you have from 0 to 18 years. So it makes things much more simpler. You start plotting him at birth and see whether he is cruising along his centile. This is for weight, this is for height, weight for height. So to make things simpler, they are combined together. Okay. Now, coming to the basics of the growth chart, I have just highlighted many things. Again, I would like to highlight. Okay. So use appropriate growth charts. For under 5 children, you would use the WHO growth charts, which are simplified by IAP. For children above 5 years, you would use the new IAP growth charts 2015, which were made available to us in 2017. Okay. So they are very recent. So the growth charts should be age, gender specific, country specific, and most importantly, they should be recent. Okay, now the components of the growth chart. On the x-axis, we have the age in years or months. Y-axis may have the height in centimeters or the weight in kg or the BMI in kg per meter square. The background of the growth charts is a grid. Pink is for girls, blue is for boys. Okay, standard charts have 7 percentile lines. Okay, starting from 3rd, 10th, 25th, 50th, 75th, 97th. Okay. 50th centile is the average line. Weight, height, BMI, head circumference, whatever you are plotting should be plotted as a single dot. Okay, not a dot followed by a circle. Many times it is done. You put a dot and then you circle it. It is just by a single dot. Any child below the 3rd centile and above the 97th centile for the age group 5 to 18 is considered abnormal. And movement of a reading, suppose you have plotted up the parameter today and he comes to us, say, after 3 months. If he has shot up or gone down in weight, okay, that cannot happen in height. Height cannot go down. Okay, but in weight, if he has shot up or is going down by 2 percentile lines, that is considered to be abnormal. Okay, some charts are given in standard deviations. Instead of percentile lines, they're standard deviations. And the BMI charts have additionally an 85th and a 95th percentile line, which is used to define overweight and obesity. So that is very simple. It is, the 85th is in orange, which is overweight, and the 95th is in red, which is dangerous, which is obesity. Okay. Now again, just a recap. Centile lines, 7 centile lines. Okay. Now, plotting the parameters. So now when you plot the weight, you just plot it as a single dot. When you plot the height, again, as a single dot for that particular age, you will plot your parameter. Now when it comes to height, what else would you do? You would calculate the target height of that age. Now when a child comes to you, again I said, say a 5-year-old boy, he is 105 centimeters, his weight is say 20 kg. So is that height normal or not? Okay, based on the growth chart, we can simply say that yes, this is on the 25th percentile, it is normal. But we need to go one step further and see whether he is growing as per his genetic potential. Maybe at that time, at that point, it is normal, but we need to see that how is he doing as far as his genetic potential is concerned. So we take the height of the parents into consideration. So based on that, we calculate the target height of the patient, which means that what height should the child reach at 18 years when he becomes, when his height stops. I mean, as an adult, that is the height he should reach based on his parents' height. So if the parents are very tall, the target height of the child will also be more, okay, based on the parents' height. But if a patient is brought to you for short stature, so-called short stature, and you see the parents, they too are very short, but they want their child to grow taller. you have to calculate his potential, his genetic potential or his target height. That at 18 years, what height is he expected to achieve based on his parents' height? And if that you have calculated and the centile line of that is, you know, the child is on the same centile line, then you can assure them that your child is not short. It is just because you are slightly short, he is short, and this is what he will achieve. Okay, so it is very important to interpret the child's height in relation to the parent's height. So that is called adjustment for family or parent's size and calculating the target height. So how do you calculate the target height? For a boy, mother's height plus father's height plus 13 divided by 2. For a girl, it is mother's height plus father's height minus 13 divided by 2. Okay. Now, once we get the target height, where do you plot this target height? At what age? When I say target height, it is the target adult height. So, at what age will you plot that height? 18. So, at 18 years, you will plot that height and you will mark it as the target height. This is the average height the child should achieve. But everything has a range. So, you have to add 6 and subtract 6. So, plus 6 above and minus 6 below, that becomes his range. So, anywhere between that range, he should fall. Okay. So, if he falls below that range of height, he should be investigated further. And if he is above that, he should be again investigated further. Okay. So, the target range is 6 centimeters below and 6 centimeters above the target height. Okay. Now, this is how we calculate the target height. Suppose it's a 9-year-old boy. Okay. So, 9. Okay. His height is 116 centimeters. Weight is 20 kg we have plotted. Father is 157, mother 150. Based on that formula, his target height is coming to 160. Okay. So, plot 160 at 18 years. Plus 6 minus 6. So, this and this is the range. So, you can draw an imaginary line and create his target range. Okay. So, that child should fall within that range. Now, this child is below the third centile, national centile. So, by definition, he is short stature. He should be further investigated. But on correction for family height, he is within his range. So, by definition, again, further, he is not short stature. So, this is the importance of checking, adjusting for the family height. Now, there is something known as height age and weight age. So, height age and weight age is nothing. You are trying to compare how he falls on the weight chart as compared to how he fares on the height chart. So, if he is doing very well on the weight chart, means he is on the side, I mean, on the verge of overweight, but he is not growing on the height chart. So, he is short and obese. Okay, that helps us in our diagnosis. If he is tall and obese, we think of something else. If he is short and obese, we think of something else. If he is short and thin, you know, it gives us a clue to the diagnosis. So, for this purpose, we do calculate the child's weight age and the height age. Now, this is how we calculate it. This is the weight. Okay, this is the height. And for calculating that is the target height and the range, family range. Now, for calculating the height age, what we do is, we draw a horizontal from the parameter till where it reaches the 50th centile. Okay. Now, this is the weight, this is the height, sorry. We draw a horizontal till it meets the 50th centile and then we draw a perpendicular down. The age that we get here is his height age. This means that a child of this age, this height is normal for a child of whatever we get below. Okay. Now here, the child is around 8 years. Okay. No, sorry. The child is 11 years. We have plotted the height here. Okay, we dropped a horizontal till it reaches the 50th centile and a vertical down here. So, his height age is just coming to 8 years. Okay, so a child of 11 years, but his height age is 8 years. You got my point? Similarly, for weight, for that 11-year-old child, the weight age is even further less. Okay. So the weight is affected, height is affected, but the weight affection is more than the height affection. Okay. So based on these calculations, we can come to a diagnosis. So what is affected more, the weight or the height? Okay. When we are dealing with growth of a child around puberty, so 10 years and onwards, always do a SMR or a Tanner staging in that child, because we have to interpret the growth and the growth chart with respect to the Tanner staging. Okay, and one step further, when we get a referral for growth and we are plotting, we plot the growth chart, and for coming to a diagnosis, many a times we have to do the bone ages of the child. So the bone age is nothing but the skeletal age of the child, and it gives and it correlates very well with the pubertal changes. Means the SMR and the bone age go hand in hand. So this means, bone age helps us further in diagnosing the type of short stature, which I'll try to tell you in the further slides. For example, if you have a boy who is just around 5 years, okay, these are his parameters. His height is 120 centimeters, weight is 17 kg. We did his bone age. His bone age is 10 years. Okay, so a boy of chronological age, 4.7. Okay, chronological age is around 5. Bone age is 10. So the bone age is delayed or advanced? It is very advanced. So it is almost advanced by 5.3 years. Okay, now we also did his height age and his weight age. Okay, and we found that his bone age is very much advanced, followed by his height age, followed by his weight age, which was equal to the chronological age. So based on this equation, we can come to a diagnosis and we can strongly say that it is an endocrine disorder. Okay, so it is very important to correlate everything with the chronological age, height age, weight age, and the bone age. Okay, now this is the example, same example. Okay, now this boy around 5 years, he is very tall. You can see he is falling on the above the 97th centile. So it's straight away a case of tall stature, very, very tall. Okay, and his age is just 5 years, around 5 years. And weight wise, he is on the 50th centile. So weight wise, he is doing well, but he is very, very tall. Okay, so the next, so he is tall, but thin. I mean, not obese. So here, especially when we get children with tall stature, we should always do an SMR and a bone age. Why? Because many of the children who come to present to us as tall stature may have precocious puberty. Okay, so they are taller than the other children who are not yet into puberty. So when we get a tall child, it is always good to do a Tanner staging along with a bone age. Now, the bone age of this child, okay, now we did the height age as well as the weight age. The weight age was almost the same, but the height age is advanced. So the child was just 5, but his height age was around 7. Okay, we further did a bone age. And the bone age, we always mark the bone age on a growth chart with a cross. Okay, the bone age was even more advanced. So it was around 10 years. The same example which I showed you back. Okay, so how do you plot for the bone age? We did the bone age and we plotted it, and it fell on 10 years. So based on these, the chronological age, bone age, height age, and weight age, we can simply, based on a growth chart, come to a clinical diagnosis even without investigating. Of course, we do investigate blood tests and all, but this gives us a very good idea about the diagnosis of a child. So would like to highlight the importance of very good growth charting. Okay, similarly, now this was advanced bone age. Similarly, we had a 10-year-old girl who came to us with short stature. She was very, very short, and her height age corresponded to just 5.4 years. So a 10-year-old girl, height age was just 5.4 years. Weight was fair. It was not abnormally. It was not too deviant. We did the bone age. The bone age was 5 years. So what is the difference here in the bone age? it is 5 years, but it is retarded. Okay. So there it was 5 year advanced, here it is 5 years retarded. So by putting it into that equation, we have chronological age is more than the weight age, which is more than the height age, but the bone age is maximally delayed. So when we get such a kind of an equation, again this increases the chances of an endocrine disorder. So the first one was something like precocious puberty. The second one is classically seen in, where do we get bone skeletal age retardation, hypothyroidism or growth hormone deficiency. Okay, so these are two classical examples of endocrine pathology. Okay, so the same thing. There we went to the right side. Everything was on the right side in when it is advanced. Okay, now the arrows are on the left side because everything is retarded. Okay, okay, so the bone age is retarded. Now everything is retarded, height age, weight age, there it was all advanced. Okay. Now that was just about the simple charts we use in day-to-day practice, the height, the weight and the head circumference BMI charts. There are some other charts also available, but like not to be used or it's not required in our daily practice, day-to-day practice. These are the height velocity charts, we have the proportionate charts. Some children with skeletal dysplasia or achondroplasias, they have abnormal upper segment, lower segment ratios. So for such children, we have proportion charts. Okay, then we also need to resort to disease-specific charts. Suppose we have a child with Turner syndrome. We have to plot these children not on normal growth charts, but we have to plot them on special charts which are made only for these conditions. So we have Down syndrome charts, we have Turner syndrome charts, achondroplasia charts. So it is always good to plot them on those disease specific charts. Okay. Now, just quickly, with the help of growth charts, what all can we diagnose? We can diagnose short stature. Okay. Now, before labeling a child as short, we have to think twice, is this child really short? Is the child really short? So for that, first of all, we should ensure a few things. Okay? We should record the exact age in years and months. So date of birth is a must. Always take the date of birth, exact date of birth. If they don't remember, make them remember. Okay? Somehow or the other, we need the date of birth and record the age in exact years and months. Measure the height accurately. Okay, this is the wrong way. This is the right way. Okay, measure both the parents. Because even if he appears to be short on the growth chart, we have to correct him for the family height many times. They are not short on further adjustment for family, and use appropriate chart. Do not use CDC charts or American charts. Use Indian charts and age specific charts. Okay. Now, what is abnormal as far as height is concerned? Children who are below the third centile for the nation. I mean, on the growth charts, if they are below the third centile, consider it abnormal. But correct it for family. If it is slightly less than third centile, but within the family range, it is not short stature. Second point is children below the target range for family. If it is a tall family, the child appears to be tall, but he is slightly below his family range. Okay, again that may be abnormal. And a movement of a reading across two centile lines downwards. Today you have taken a reading, after 6 months you see him again and he is, maybe after a year you have seen him and he has dropped down two centiles from the 10th centile or the 25th centile, he has dropped to the third centile. Okay, height doesn't reduce, but the rate of growth decreases. So then that is also considered as abnormal and you should start investigations. Okay, now this is a very simple, slide which will give us some clues. Now, how far below the third centile? Okay, now below the, is your child just here, just here, just here, or is way below? Okay, so this simple slide will tell you. Okay, now this child is just below the third centile. So think of these causes. It could be just idiopathic short stature or familial short stature or constitutional delay in growth and puberty, which is very, very common. Or it could be chronic malnutrition, or it may be a child is born small, preterm, low birth weight, small for gestational age. Okay, so not very far from the third centile. Think of these causes of short stature which are not very severe. But if the child is way below the third centile, think of more severe forms of short stature like endocrine hormonal disorders or endocrine causes like hypothyroidism, growth hormone deficiency. It could be bony problems like skeletal dysplasias, achondroplasias, Okay, or it could be very severe chronic diseases, chronic renal disease or, you know, renal tubular acidosis and all such severe chronic illnesses. Okay, now small dictums, short and thin. The child is short, but along with that he is very thin. Think of malnutrition or chronic illnesses. He is short but fat. Think of endocrine causes. Okay, now when a child comes to you for tall stature, okay. Usually children are not brought for tall stature because the parents are very happy my child is tall. But on examination, on anthropometry, as a part of your essential clinical compulsory examination, you find that he is on above the 97th centile, he is somewhere here. The parents will be very happy because everybody likes, tallness is something everyone likes. But you have to be alarmed. You should be alarmed. Why is this child so tall? His parents are not so tall. So then what will you do next? SMR, because still the most important cause of tall stature in our scenario is precocious puberty or early puberty. So do an SMR, do a bone age. If you get an advanced bone age, okay, we have to counsel the parents that this child looks tall now, but he is not going to be tall as an adult because soon his epiphysis will fuse and he will stop growing when the other children start growing. So a tall child now at this age does not always mean that he will be tall as a adult. So if he fulfills the criteria of precocious puberty, that is onset of puberty below 8 years in girls and before 9 years in boys, you should investigate him further. Okay, because otherwise he'll lose his height and he'll end up being a short adult. Okay, now the next dictum, obesity. For 5 to 18 years, you're going to use the 5 to 18 years BMI charts. He is obese but tall. What is the possibility, which is very commonly seen these days? Obese with good height, tall and obese, nutritional. Okay, so the incidence of obesity is increasing a lot. But he is obese and short. What would you think of? Endocrine cause. Now for obesity, 0 to 5 years of age, is it common? It is rising, but people don't pay attention to it. People are very happy if a child is chubby and healthy, okay, because it is equated to good health, but it is not. Okay, because the same obesity tracks into childhood and tracks into adult. So it is very important to identify obesity even in the 0 to 5 year old age group. And for that you use the weight for height charts, as I told you earlier, WHO weight for height charts. And anything more than the 99th centile, they have given a special 99 centile here. Anything more than 99 centile is obesity for 0 to 5 years. Now coming to the last group is wasting or malnutrition. Very, very important. Probably more important from your point of view. From an endocrinologist point of view, it is short stature, obesity. But in general practice or in our day-to-day general pediatric practice, this is very, very important. So all our PG students have to understand these charts very, very well. Okay, so wasting in a 0 to 5 year old child, wasting or acute malnutrition, which charts are you going to use? The WHO weight for height charts. Okay, this is a very, very important chart. Weight for height, 0 to 5. Okay, so this is used to define malnutrition, acute malnutrition or wasting. Anything below the yellow line or the third centile, okay, anything below the yellow and the red line is moderate acute malnutrition. Anything below the red line is severe acute malnutrition. And it is this chart that is used by the government of India, by the Anganwadi workers, by the ICDS workers to identify children with SAM, that is what we call SAM and MAM. SAM stands for severe acute malnutrition. Anything below the red line is SAM. They refer these children to hospitals if it is SAM. But if it is MAM, that is moderate acute malnutrition, between the yellow line and the red line, the Anganwadi workers give their children over there, you know, midday meals and some high protein and high calorie diet to improve the nutrition status. So these charts are used even by being WHO charts, they are recommended by the government of India and our government and all these health schemes, the Anganwadis, those peripheral health workers are using this chart to identify malnutrition in the community and for appropriate referral and treatment. Now then we know what is wasting or malnutrition, what is stunting. So wasting means acute malnutrition, their height may not be affected. But as opposed to wasting, we have one more terminology called stunting. So what is stunting? The word stunting says that the height is also affected. Okay. So wasting is only weight affected and stunting is both weight as well as height is affected. So for stunting, you go for the height charts, height for age charts, the WHO height for age charts. Okay. Anything below the red line is severe stunting, between the yellow and the red line is stunting. So stunting and severe stunting. And the etiology here is, it is malnutrition, but it is chronic malnutrition. So when weight as well as height both are affected, especially the height is affected, this means it is chronic malnutrition. And in acute malnutrition, it is, the height is relatively preserved, it is the weight which is affected. Okay. Now the next question, where can you all get the growth charts from, the IP growth charts from? So these charts may be available in the form of paper by, you know, some, there are some companies which provide these charts to doctors. Okay, so they provide these charts to us free of cost. You just have to approach them. Okay, because we are into endocrine practice, we have many company and medical representatives who come and who distribute these growth charts. However, the best way for you all to do is just to download the app, the IAP growth chart app. Okay. So our next best friend is the mobile. Okay. So we can now get the IAP growth chart app on your mobile phone. So on Google or iPhone store, go and click on the IAP growth chart app. Okay. So, if you are, you can do it now also if you want to, provided you have, so this is how you can go. Go to Google, Play Store, iStore, search for the IAP growth chart, click and install, start using the application. So, this is what you would, once you install it, this is what you would see, okay, the IAP growth chart application developed by the IAP Growth Chart Committee 2014. IAP stands for Indian Academy of Pediatrics. Okay. Pioneering work done by Dr. Khadilkar. Okay. This is the first thing you get. Enter the details. Okay. Whether your child is a girl or a boy, click age in years and months. Very, very important. Years and months. Okay. Because everything is age related, age dependent. Okay. Put the weight, put the height, put the head circumference, put the mother's height, put the father's height. Okay, this is what you get. Okay, once you have entered it, click, again click. Okay, so you get graphs like this. This is the WHO weight for height. If your child is less than 5 years, you will get the WHO charts. Okay, everything comes ready-made. Okay, this is plotted and even the interpretation is given. Height is less than the first centile. Z score is minus 3, so the patient is severely stunted. Okay. This is for height for age above 5 years, so it is the IAP growth chart. Okay. So they have again interpreted it. Height is less than the third centile. Patient is stunting. Okay. And similarly for weight with the interpretation given. So everything is at the click of the button. Okay. So these charts are so well made. The quality of these charts is so good that the IAP's growth charts are now in the Dutch International Registry. IAP's efforts are acknowledged even by the British, the BMJ, and it is already cited by many, many research papers. Okay. And the citations are increasing day by day. The last number of citations used by researchers was 77. Okay. So, we have with us a very, very useful tool, very simple tool, very easy to use. So, everybody should make use of it. Okay? I would say from my side, what will be most useful to you is reassurance. You would be reassured that you are not failing as a doctor in identifying deviant growth. Okay? In a few patients, you may identify deviant growth if they are based on the definitions I told you, if they are deviating, you can anytime always refer such patients to us. But in 90% of the patients, it is a great reassurance to yourself as well as to your patients. If you show them their chart visually, they see your child is doing so well. I mean, I would say the work is done. And everybody is happy and reassured. So growth charts, use IP specified age appropriate growth charts. Every child must have a growth chart updated. At least from the height point of view, every 3 to 6 monthly. Weight, we do it at every visit. They are available to download from the IP website or are being distributed. If you know anybody, use the growth chart application on phone or your tab if you find it difficult to manually plot it. Manual plotting is also not difficult, but many of us, even our students, our fellow pediatricians feel very scared of plotting the growth charts. But it is not very difficult. Just in case that is the case, you can use the app. And overweight and obesity is also very easy to detect with the new IAP growth charts. We know about short stature, we know about malnutrition, but a rising problem is obesity and overweight. So we should not neglect that in our population, because we as Indians have a very high risk of future metabolic complications. So also, timely detection of overweight and obesity and appropriate treatment is a must. Thank you.